Tonight, the Speaker of the House of Assembly denies reports of a heart attack after being hospitalized following a marathon parliamentary session. The Prime Minister welcomes the softening of the OECD stance on the classification of small island developing states. The Ministry of Health concerned about an increase in cases of leptospirosis. And Guy Joseph welcomes an investigation into alleged corrupt practices into the Yurinora International Airport redevelopment project. Very good evening to you. Welcome to the Wednesday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Folio. Our top story. The Speaker of the House of Assembly, Leon Theodore John, is reportedly recovering well after being hospitalized yesterday. The Speaker took ill during this week's sitting of Parliament, reviving concerns about her ability to continue overseeing the marathon sessions without a Deputy Speaker to assist. This week's incident does not, however, appear like it will hasten the election of a deputy, as neither side appears ready to budge or to sacrifice one of its members. DBS's Don Nicholas begins our news coverage.
Prime Minister Alan Chesney said various countries the world over, the deputy speaker is usually chosen from the opposition. The Prime Minister was speaking in the context of Tuesday's sitting in the House, in which the Speaker of the House, Leon Theodore John, fell ill and had to be hospitalized.
At the end of the day, in order to be a Deputy Speaker, a person cannot hold a cabinet portfolio. And so the precedents have been established all over the world in which opposition people are the Deputy Speaker. The Deputy Speaker is just a person who is going to substitute for a speaker during the sessions of the House. This is nothing more than that, and they get some additional compensation. So, I mean, I would hope that the opposition would be willing to appoint a deputy speaker, but the fact is they seem very hell-bent on not doing that and putting the pressure on the government.
The SLP is adamant that the deputy speaker of the House should be chosen from the incumbent party. But the ruling party is just as adamant that its members are already burdened with other responsibilities and as a result cannot take on that role.
It always would be in the best interest. But again, at the end of the day, the fact is that there are six members on the other side who don't hold a portfolio.
Having said that, the Prime Minister was happy to report that the Speaker is in good health and spirits. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Meanwhile, the Speaker of the House of Assembly has been discharged from hospital and has been clearing the air on what transpired during Tuesday's sitting. She has also dismissed rumors that she suffered a heart attack. She spoke to Sheffield Gillard.
Discharged Wednesday morning, the House Speaker dismissed rumors that she suffered a heart attack. Recounting events that took place in Parliament Tuesday night, Theodore John said she felt exhausted and drained.
The truth be told, I actually felt chest pain and constriction. There was difficulty breathing. I do not know what it is, and it was very painful. So I was taken to the hospital where I was treated. Cardiologist Dr. Daniel was there. We did all of the EKGs. He also did a heart scan. All my valves are normal. There is nothing about a heart attack. He ruled all of that out. This morning, I did a stress test before he released me. My blood pressure, however, is very high. And he released me this morning and gave me some medication, and I went home. Rumors about a heart attack or whatever. I did not suffer a heart attack. I was feeling some tightness in my chest, but it had nothing to do with a heart attack. Not every tightness in the chest is a heart attack. I think I was suffering from mental and physical fatigue and exhaustion.
Despite not having a deputy speaker to relieve her, Mrs. Theodore John says her fatigue was not as a result of pressure from Parliament. She attributes it to her recent travels overseas, coupled with her Junequeol activities. This latest incident has prompted fresh calls for the appointment of a deputy speaker. However, neither the government nor the opposition wants to nominate a suitable candidate. Opposition leader Philip Pierre says while he empathizes with the speaker, the opposition is not interested in the deputy speaker position.
Never in the Convention of Parliament, Sir John Compton, who is the father of the nation, anytime he was in government, with the exact same situation, he appointed a deputy speaker. The prime minister wants to make every one of his members ministers. He's presiding over the largest cabinet in the history of St. Lucia. It's his responsibility. The opposition has said to him, we are not interested in the position of deputy speaker, and opposition holds. The women of this country must understand, the deputy speaker is a woman. All of us can leave parliament at any time to go to the washroom, but she can't. I feel very sorry for her, but that's the situation that her government has put her in.
The House is without a deputy and it requires a deputy, which I have said. However, demanding a deputy is not my place to demand a deputy. It is the parliamentarians who have to understand that there is need for a deputy.
Sarah Flood Bowbray was appointed deputy speaker at the opening of the first session of the 11th parliament, but subsequently resigned and was appointed external affairs minister. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, Prime Minister Alan Chastney has welcomed moves by the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development to reclassify small island developing states as middle-income nations. This classification is severely affecting their ability to access much-needed financing. Meanwhile, natural disasters and climate change are severely affecting the growth trajectory of these islands and their ability to achieve sustainable development. Don Nicholas explains.
Prime Minister Chastney has always expressed concern that small island developing states should not be categorized as middle-income nations, meaning that they do not qualify for concessionary funds in the aftermath of natural disasters. The Prime Minister is elated that this is about to change. At a meeting of the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development on Tuesday, authorities decided to reclassify small states.
A report to Parliament talking about the issue with regards to climate change. And one of the key areas that we identified was that we, as small states, continue to be classified by the OECD and the ODA as middle-income countries on one determinant, which is the per capita income. And so the UK government took a lead in this issue after the hurricanes. And I'm very happy to report that yesterday at the OECD board meeting and ODA board meeting, it has been agreed to change that classification.
At a time when climate change is causing unpredictable weather, Prime Minister Chastney believes this represents good timing.
Therefore, we should be hearing very soon that the smaller states like ours will be reclassified in order to allow us to be able to get concessionary funds. So this is a massive breakthrough. And I really want to say thank you to the British Prime Minister, the Minister of Finance, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, and also Priti Patel, the Minister of Development for the UK, for taking such quick action and so urgent in resolving this problem.
The Prime Minister says this is a huge step forward. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
And now this. Transport and Civil Aviation Minister Guy Joseph has welcomed an investigation into alleged corruption associated with the Uranora International Airport redevelopment project in 2008-2009 while he was a government minister. We hear more in this report.
The investigation was launched by the former Prime Minister, Dr. Kenny Anthony. According to reports, the Attorney General at the time sought U.S. government assistance to probe suspected bribery surrounding the $157 million airport redevelopment project.
We have actually put together a small team to conduct an internal investigation. Because you could imagine, we saw some of the documents that were in circulation. None of those documents are in government files. So at this point, I stand here and I cannot even confirm to you the authenticity of those documents. We know that Mr. Lindquist, as we have reported previously, we found out Mr. Lindquist was hired. We found out Mr. Lindquist has been paid over $1 million. We've also found out that there are processes in government that did not follow the right processes. In fact, they didn't even have the contracts. So as I said, we've put together a small team that will be carrying out an investigation to find out how all this happened, what the status of the situation is. And as soon as I have that information, I will be able to report to the citizens of this country and also to the media on what the status is.
It is alleged that during key points in the project bidding process, there was an extensive telephone activity between Minister Guy Joseph, who was then Minister of Communication and Works, Sean Matthew, who was at the time SLASPA General Manager, and Antonio Asenza, the head of the construction firm Asphalt and Mining Limited. Minister Guy Joseph says he has nothing to fear and welcomes the investigation.
I have no problems with any investigations being done. If there is an investigation. And I indicated that. I indicated that from very early. That when they did the forensic audit on Guy Joseph, they paid about $3 million to investigate Guy Joseph. Found nothing. For that matter, let me not say they found nothing. I've asked for the report. I'm still asking for the report. And that is the problem in government. How could the state pay $3 million for an investigation and the report cannot be found anywhere in the Attorney General's office? Secondly, this report, when Mr. Robert Linguist was contacted by the government, he said he was dealing directly with the AG. And I brought the cabinet conclusion to show what happened. That this was an investigation done by through the AG and the then Prime Minister, Dr. Kenny Anthony. I have been informed that when they did not get anything on me, they launched an investigation on the MLAT, Money Laundering and Anti-Terrorism Act. That is how far I understood that they went to undermine me and to see to it that I don't run elections. So, as to if there is an investigation or whether there is an investigation, that will be revealed in time. Because the information that must come out will come out. But I'm not worried. If there's an investigation, I welcome the investigation. Because I know what the outcome of the investigation is going to be. I don't need anybody to tell me that. So if it happens, then all of us will see in time.
Joseph went on to justify the number of calls he allegedly made to Antonio Asenza while Asphalt and Mining was bidding for a contract from his ministry.
Asphalt and Mining and the airport project was one project. Asphalt and Mining was doing several road projects within the Ministry of Communications and Works, of which I was the minister. So, to make phone calls, all my phone call records are there. I have said it before, and you can see all the people that I called. I didn't know it was illegal to call people.
Joseph stressed that he does not want any investigation against him stopped. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Street Vibes. The Ministry of Health has noted a spike in leptospirosis cases here on island. What do you know about leptospirosis?
Well, leptospirosis is a disease caused by rats, and if prolonged, it can cause jaundice.
Leptospirosis, yes, is a disease caused by rats and other animals, probably dogs, cats. You know, it comes in different forms though. You know, that's all I know about it.
What do you think would be done to eliminate it?
Well, one of the major things I think we should do as a people to keep these diseases out is to clean our environment, our homes, get rid of of old water, stagnant water that is in drums, tires.
It's something to be very afraid of. It's illness caused by rats, and we should take that very serious. Too many rats in the country.
What do you think could be done to eliminate the disease itself?
We need to clean up the place, clean up the garbage around the place. And let me see, the government need to take garbage a lot more seriously. Too many rats in the place. Keep bushes down and keep the trash and rubbish off the streets.
Leptospirosis? Yes. But they say it's rat that causing that putting that. So I don't know much about it, about from what they say in there, because I hear people say it's rat that causing these things.
So what do you think could be done?
Oh, well, like what I believe that could be done is try and destroy these rats. That's the main thing. Unless they destroy them, you will always find that.
Well, to tell the truth, I don't know nothing about it. Huh?
You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Street. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You are watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, the island security minister applies pressure on police to solve recent murders, and government announces the early granting of concessions on Christmas barrels. Thank you so much for staying with the DBS News World. National Security Minister Senator Herman Gil Francis is calling for more aggression on the part of the police in apprehending criminals and solving crime. With Ireland already recording 48 homicides for the year, he is pushing for more patrols in well-known hotspots and is applying pressure on officers to resolve the recent murders. Don Nicholas has the details.
National Security Minister Herman Gil Francis called for a heavier police presence in crime hotspots. As far as he's concerned, 48 homicides for the year is far too many. The minister added that many of the perpetrators are well known to the police.
I want to see a little more aggression from the police, that the police has to go out there and follow these guys. I mean, most of these persons are known, you know. If you look at the victims, there's something called victimization or victimology. If you look at victimology, there is a relation between the victim and the perpetrator, and we need to investigate that connection and deal with it.
A regional security system meeting in Barbados on Sunday brought together permanent secretaries in the ministries responsible for security, as well as police commissioners, to discuss new crime-fighting strategies.
We seem to concentrate on homicides as crime. Homicides is homicides. The overall crime is there are various incidents that you cannot ascribe. The criminal code is bereft with the number of crimes that are there. Yes, we have an escalation. We have an escalation with homicides. The RSS can assist as we did with St. Kitts, when the crime rate went up very drastically. We asked for the RSS to come in, and the RSS did come in.
At the end of the day, according to Senator Francis, the onus is on the local law enforcement authorities to reduce crime. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
In other news, on October 24th this year, the Cabinet of Ministers approved the granting of concessions on barrels imported for the period 15th November this year to January 31st of next year. The concessions and conditions include 100% waiver of import duty on personal items, food, clothing, toys and other household consumables contained in barrels imported between the 15th of November this year and the 31st of January next year. Electronic items are explicitly excluded. The number of barrels that would qualify for the concessions would be limited to 2 per household. There is an upper limit of $2,500 per barrel on the value of items qualifying for the concessions. The items contained in the barrels must be for personal use only and not for commercial use. Usual penalties and fines apply if the goods are used for commercial purposes. Speaking at the House of Assembly yesterday, Prime Minister and Minister for Finance Alan Chastney announced the barrel concessions would start 2 weeks earlier than usual, but for the same duration of 2.5 months. He said the earlier period was intended to facilitate the ease of clearance of the barrels to avoid as much as possible the hectic Christmas traffic at the ports. The Ministry of Health and Wellness has noted a reported increase in the cases of leptospirosis, though increases in the number of cases is not unusual after periods of heavy rains or flooding. It remains an issue of concern to health authorities. Don Nicholas has that story.
Leptospirosis is a disease caused by a bacteria which can be found in some animals, including rats, cattle, pigs, horses, and dogs. Persons can become ill if they are in contact with urine, water, food, or soil through breaks in the skin, mouth, eyes, or nose. Symptoms can range from a mild flu-like illness with high fever, chills, headache, muscle pains, red eye, sore throat, and occasionally rash, which may worsen with time. If left untreated, it may result in death. The Ministry of Health is reporting an increase in the number of cases. Authorities say this is not unusual during the rainy season.
The Ministry of Health has noted an increase in the number of reported cases of leptospirosis. It is not unusual to have an increase in cases of leptospirosis after heavy rainfall or after flooding. Leptospirosis is basically a bacterial infection, and in our setting, it is mostly transmitted by the urine of rats, but it could also be transmitted by other animals, for example, horses, pigs, and dogs. It is basically treatable. Leptospirosis is a treatable disease. Some of the signs and symptoms of lepto could be very mild, so it could go from basic flu symptoms to more severe ones.
If left untreated, the disease can affect organs such as the brain, kidneys, lungs, and other internal organs. Most at-risk groups would be farm and sewer workers. Precautionary measures include wearing protective clothing and covering foods properly.
We want the public to do actually is to protect themselves. And some of the ways in which you could protect yourself would be, if you have a break in your skin, a cut in our setting, you need to cover this up properly. You may want to use waterproof plasters, etc. We want the farmers or those persons who are going out to take soil, etc., that they need to use proper protective clothing. That may mean gloves, it may mean shoes, it may mean other clothing. We also want persons to ensure that their foods are covered properly. They're stored properly in containers, for example. We want to make sure that your surfaces are always clean.
Persons displaying the symptoms are asked to seek medical attention immediately. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The Department of Commerce, International Trade, Investment, Enterprise Development and Consumer Affairs is working with various affiliate agencies to promote a spirit of entrepreneurship among St. Lucians. The department hopes to do so through a series of activities to mark November as Business Month.
The department has designated November as Business Month under the theme Promoting an Entrepreneurial Culture, Innovation and Creativity. The aim of the month-long celebration is to promote an entrepreneurial spirit among St. Lucians so more persons can decide to take the plunge into business for themselves.
We want to encourage our business persons to think creatively and to think innovation. We recognize that without innovation and creativity, businesses cannot survive. When we look at the leading businesses in the wider world, we recognize that one of the reasons why they are on top is because they have innovation and creativity as their number one strategy. So we want to start, we want to basically bring up this idea among our business persons or the business sector so that they could start thinking out of the box. They could start pushing the limits in terms of creativity and innovation.
A number of activities and events are planned for the month-long observance.
We have our finance symposium, which takes place on the 8th of November. It's a symposium basically set for business persons so that they would find out what are the options for financing that is available, how do they qualify, So we have a number of persons from the financial sector who would be coming to do presentations so that persons could basically get an understanding of how could they qualify for financing. We also have a digital marketing symposium, again, the aim of which is to help persons to improve their digital marketing. We also have a number of activities that would be geared towards the participants of the St. Lucia Taiwan Expo. As you know, the St. Lucia Taiwan Partnership Trade Show would be taking place on the 24th to the 26th of November. So leading up to this activity, we have a number of training sessions for our participants to help them to prepare for the trade show, to help them to better be able to present their products themselves, to help them to speak better, to help them to basically put their best foot forward at this event.
The Department of Commerce and Consumer Affairs encourages the participation and support of the business community and the general public in the various events in observance of Business Month. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Still to come on the DBS News World, hundreds of secondary school students get help making career and college choices. The annual St. Lucia College Fair commenced today, with students from secondary schools across the island invited to interact with representatives from participating colleges. The fair gives students the opportunity to both familiarize themselves with a variety of schools they may have already been familiar with, as well as to introduce them to schools they may not have previously considered. Alex Buske explains.
Schools from across the island converged at the Financial Administrative Center on Wednesday for the annual St. Lucia College Fair. A number of tertiary education institutions were on hand to provide information on courses of study, scholarships, and other sources of funding.
Basically, just information about the programs that are available, the areas that they're interested in, how they will fund their studies. That's the main thing, because funding education, that's very critical. And that is the point where students either enter or they don't, because that is where we have the major problem. But the information is there, and we encourage everybody to come in and grab some information. The persons, the reps are there, and they will give you the information to make a sound decision.
Approximately 12 institutions assisted the students from 26 secondary schools on island. Human Resource Development Officer within the Ministry of Education, Dennis Inglis, says students showed a lot of enthusiasm.
We're expecting that students will be curious. They will go on the websites, look at what scholarships are available, what areas they're interested in studying, pursuing whatever career. So we're inviting everybody to come in, get the information. And also we have ACT, that's the American College Testing, which is similar to SAT. And that is where you can take an exam with the possibility of accessing scholarships.
The St. Lucia Annual College Fair has been in existence from 2004. The fair takes place over 2 days. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
The Youth in Arts Theatre Company is getting set to stage the third annual Roderick Walcott production Strove Tuesday March and Pan Beating. The theatrical piece is being presented tonight and tomorrow. We hear more in this report.
For 3 years, the Youth in Arts Theatre Company has successfully presented the Roderick Walcott production series. Theatre practitioner and director of the play, Kendall Hippolyte, says that the production of Roderick Walcott's work is ready to highlight his invaluable contribution to the theatrical landscape of St. Lucia and his love for Carnival and Pan.
Roderick Walcott is well known as a theatre person, you know, as a director, as a playwright, as, you know, set designer and so on. But a lot of persons don't know that he was also a carnival person. He was a steel band man. He led a steel band. He was the designer of the Turks Carnival Band and so on. So that's an aspect of his life that hasn't sort of come to the forefront much. So this production focuses on that aspect of his life. So the play, this is in two components. The play that we're doing, Shrove Tuesday March, it's set in a panyard. Written by him, written by Roderick Walcott.
Patrons can also expect to be entertained by the performance of the piece Pan Beating, a creative blend of local calypsos describing Pan music in St. Lucia.
We also devised a production about Pan in St. Lucia. And the story of Pan in St. Lucia is in many ways similar to the story of Pan elsewhere in the Caribbean. So it's looking at the glories, celebrating it and all the good things about it, what it does for people and so on. But also looking at the tough side, at the struggles that Pan has had to face, the fact that some persons lost interest, it's a struggle bringing them back. Because this is not written by a playwright and it's devised, what we've done is we've asked particular calypso writers like Trescott Augustine, T.C. Brown, Nahum Jean-Baptiste. We have the work of Mighty Paley. So we've taken some calypsos and used the lyrics of these calypsos as dialogue, as monologue, as chant.
Mr. Hippolyte says Roderick Walcott is a St. Lucian icon. He thinks it is important for the younger generation to take time to experience his work.
Well, for one thing, I mean, Roderick Walcott is a St. Lucian icon. And his work is so St. Lucian, you know. So for me, persons coming out, particularly the younger generation, but persons coming out now, will get to experience again why it is you are so important, what you did for theatre and so on in St. Lucia. And it's a chance for the younger generation to start to become acquainted with the work and to get enthusiastic about it. That's June's aim. So I'm encouraging everybody to come out to the cultural center tonight at 8 o'clock and tomorrow at 8 o'clock as well, and come and experience us as through Roderick Walcott.
Shrove Tuesday March and Pan Beating will take place on November 1st and 2nd, 2017, at the National Cultural Center from 8 p.m. Admission is only $50. For DBS News World, I am Daniel Dubois reporting.
The Ave Maria Primary and Infant Schools officially opened Math, Science and Music Month today. The month of activities is designed to increase the understanding and appreciation of mathematics and statistics. The theme for the month-long activities is using best practices every day. Alex Buske tells us more.
The Ave Maria Schools officially opened Math, Music and Science Month, and with telecommunications company Flow collaborating with the schools by providing free Wi-Fi, the students were able to surf various websites to access content relating to math, science and music.
One cannot live without the other. When you look at science, it's more or less a combination of math, and music is a combination of math as well as science, because you need all of them together. So then they all survive together. And then when we look at Math Month, we think that it's important because we find that our students are still struggling in mathematics, and we as teachers, we have to really try to get down to the basics and to try to help them, because actually District 3 is having a symposium on Friday where all schools in the district will be attending this math workshop, so we can look at different issues that students are facing and how we can help to solve them.
Math Month is now into its third year. Science and music were added to the month-long program recently.
So that we're doing all three together, but then we have a theme for the math, but then we've just more or less collaborated everything in one. So the theme for Math Month is using best practices every day for math and music to stay alive. And the science theme, well, we're not looking at the science theme really, but what they're doing today on a grand scale is that they're looking at using the internet in positive ways for the students. So actually Flow has come on board and we're going to have Wi-Fi open for the students, and they've brought in all of their gadgets and they can use that today. So we have collaborated everything where we're going to have booths so that students can be exposed to different websites so that they can use mathematics in a positive way, as well as English language and so on.
The opening of Math, Science and Music Month took place on Wednesday. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
The Royal St. Lucia Police Force today unveiled plans for the observance of Police Week. The activities will be held under the theme, Community Policing Begins With Me. We have a report.
On Wednesday 1st November 2017, The Royal St. Lucia Police Force officially announced plans for the observance of Police Week 2017. Some of the objectives of Police Week include strengthening the relationship between the police and local communities by encouraging dialogue and breaking down the barriers between the police and the community. It is also a time for the members themselves to socialize and highlight their talents outside of their duties. This year's theme is Community Policing Begins With Me.
The police department to hold a week of activities every year to show appreciation to our officers for their hard work and to members of the public who have assisted us during the year to celebrate how police officers make a difference in the lives of citizens, to thank God for mercies throughout the year, to increase dialogue between the police and the public, to build public trust, find time for us as officers to socialize a little more with our colleagues, and most of all, to foster a better relationship with the members of the public whom we partner with, to make our communities and our country a safer place for everyone.
The Commissioner of Police says that policing is not just about arresting people, and greater emphasis has to be placed on the community and police working together to solve crime.
One of the things that we've always said is that policing is not just about arresting people or chasing criminals. And for this week's theme, this year's theme, is quite fitting. Community policing begins with me. It's important that we understand that in crime fighting, community policing is an important aspect of crime fighting. Not only should we try to use conventional and traditional means, but it's important to use community policing to try and bridge the divide between the police and the community.
The highlight of the press briefing was the introduction and sashing of contestants for the highly anticipated Miss RSLPF and Allied Services pageant. The Department of the Police Credit Union, the Southern Division, Crown Prosecution, Predial Larceny, Bodily Correctional Facility and Crime Management will be represented. The pageant will be held on the 29th of November at the National Cultural Center. Police Week is from November 26th to December 3rd, 2017. For DBS News World, I am Daniel Dubois reporting.
When the broadcast continues in just a moment, the sports with Kenson Casimir.
Good evening and welcome to another episode of the DBS Sports. I am Kenson Casimir. Well, we begin tonight with developments in local coaching. The Department of Youth Development and Sports continue to register successes emanating from the employment of coaches around the island. Now, on Tuesday 31st, we met up with Chris Wells, who has been working with the sport of table tennis.
The coaching unit, based on the project, working through the schools throughout the island, it has enabled the sport of table tennis to get wider wings, since the majority of national players and national coaches are based in the north of the island. For the coaching unit, we have been able to penetrate all areas of the country, creating particular levels island-wide. And for us, it has worked extremely well, because for now we know that we have tournaments in every single district island-wide at the primary school level.
Well, the inter-schools table tennis tournament is currently ongoing. Mr. Wells spoke to what is needed for the sport to further develop.
Currently, I find the standard is higher than that of previous years. And what I'm impressed with most is the fact that most of the schools are led by first formers, which means there's a bright future for the next 4 years for the secondary school games. Example, the number one player at Comprehensive School is a first former. That's DeAndre Cauldron, number one player at St. Mary's College, is a form one. The captain of the Cyrus Simmons School, Ray J, is also a first former. The Goosley Secondary School, the team, entire team, first formers. So for me, I'm happy that a lot of the work in the primary school has paid off, and we see it flowing into the secondary schools. And also the fact that many of the students have filtered into a cross section of the secondary schools has created a lot of teams being evenly balanced, to the point that we can actually say there is competition. Most teams don't get a walkover as easy as they would in the past, based on school names. In the past, we'd hear, okay, St. Mary's College, once you hear St. Mary's College table tennis, you know you're going to lose. Mm-hmm. The trend has changed, because a lot of schools, they're very confident, they look at St. Mary's College, okay, that's before. What about now?
Well, in the Interschools Boys Team event, 23 teams have participated. Participants from the Soufre Comprehensive spoke about their experiences in the tournament so far.
It was okay. It was great. We had fun. Well, I liked it. We won. My teammates, they played well. I played well. So it was good.
All right, so how is table tennis? How much fun is table tennis and how much are you guys enjoying it?
We're enjoying it okay. But some of the challenge was hard.
Well, Super Comprehensive defeated Binfield Secondary 3-0 to progress in this year's tournament. Well, in Moscow sports, three matches were played on Tuesday, 31st November 2018 at the Viewford Community Court in the under-15 netball competition. In a low-scoring game, Chauzel Secondary defeated Angers Secondary 11-7 with Melanie Gustav scoring 7 out of her 23 attempts. In the second game played, Miko Secondary scraped past Soufre Comprehensive 14-12 with Megan Rackey scoring 8 of her 18 attempts. Tansy Pascal netted 11 of her 19 attempts for Soufre Comprehensive. In the final game played, Binfield Secondary squeezed past Viewford Comprehensive 8-3. But over at the Ibosejo in the facility, St. Joseph's Convent and Castries Comprehensive played to a 14-14 draw, while Corinth Secondary defeated Grand Rivière Secondary 36-8. For Corinth, Dasha Eugene netted 29 from her 33 attempts, with Aviona Modest taking 7 from her 10 attempts. In the under-19, Safa Lewis Community College defeated John Odlam Secondary 15-3. Nataki Dupree netted 13 from 23 attempts for South CC. Well, matches continued in the under-15 football competition with the following results. St. Mary's College, they defeated Bokas Secondary to continue their impressive showing at this year's event. Keyshawn James and Joachim Johnson were the goal scorers in the first half for SMC. Jason Augustine got the second half going with a goal in the 47th minute, while Keyshawn James, he completed his brace in the 57th minute. For St. Mary's College, Ziggy Hickson scored in the 68th minute to seal an impressive 5-0 victory for SMC. In another match played, Barbuno Secondary defeated Entrebo Secondary 4-1. Bertie Marcellus had a brace with goals in the 9th and the 72nd minute. Yannick Noel joined the party, registering his brace with goals in the 54th and 57th minute. For Entrebo, their lone goal was scored by Josh Harrow in the 45th minute. In other results, Vidbutai Secondary, they defeated Groseley Secondary 4-1, while Viewford Comprehensive, they also strolled past Angers Secondary 4-1. Well, national youth player Gabriel Bissett mesmerized and stunned Sandals as action continued in the Groseley Football League. Northern United C team, they defeated Sandals 3-1. The game sprung to life in the second half when the young national sensation scored a hat-trick with goals in the 44th, 65th and 72nd minute. Sandals was able to pull one back with a goal from Nigel Springer in the 80th minute. Well, in the second game, Northern United B, they defeated Royal St. Lucian Hotel 2-0. Well, Mary Terrace Street's very own Manoa Tiras Faisal, he opened the scoring for Northern in the 30th minute and he doubled the team's lead in the 34th minute to complete a brace. Well, on Tuesday night, Windjammer Landings, they got off to winning ways with a 3-2 victory over Royalton Hotel. Lawrence Pierre is the manager of Windjammer.
Well, so far, this is our first game. Well, Royalton, we had that coming for Royalton already. You know? Yeah, our last game with Royalton, they defeated us 3-0. So this time, in this competition, in this league, this Grizzly League, we decided that that's not going to happen to us again. So we came out and we executed.
DBS Sports also met up with Chansey Paul, who spoke to what happened on the field.
I must say it was a hard start in the starting, but as the game started going on, my players began to settle down in the game. Yeah, I must say we had a better game than our other matches before. I believe that the players are coming together. They are getting more acquainted with one another, and I believe my players are putting in good work, you know. Yes, we scored three goals, and it was a good play. It was a good play.
Well, the battles of the hotels has just begun, trust me. Well, the St. Lucia Football Association will be staging the Eastern Football Summit at the National Skills Development Center in Viewfort on Saturday, 4th November 2017. The event will take the form of general presentations by key personnel. This will be followed by general discussions in some instances and panel discussions. Meanwhile, following the culmination of the preliminary round of matches, the quarterfinals have been set in the SLFA President's Cup competition, with the following matchups to be staged at the Philip Master Grounds in Viewfort. On Saturday, 4th November, the KFC GMC, they take on El Niños at 6 p.m. That's definitely a good game. Rovers, they take on B1 at 8 p.m. On Sunday, Black Panthers, they take on Alès at 5 p.m. And Uptown Rebels, they take on GYMC at 7 p.m. Also a good game. The semifinals are carded for Saturday, 18th November at the Philip Master Grounds. Still in local football, this time in Derisol. In an exciting encounter, DX United defeated Blusher United 3-1. Darren Bidot opened the scoring in the 5th minute for DX, which was soon doubled by Luanja Willy in the 29th minute. Following the resumption, Tevin Pridham reduced the deficit with a goal in the 50th minute, but Nixon Samuel, he sealed the issue for DX in the 70th minute. Well, we take a break, but when we come back, the Cuban ambassador, he visits the incomplete Brand McDonald Boxing Gym. Stay tuned.
Time now for the usual reminder. The Speaker of the House of Assembly denies reports of a heart attack after being hospitalized following a marathon parliamentary session. The Prime Minister welcomes the softening of the OECD stance on the classification of small island developing states. The Ministry of Health concerned about an increase in cases of leptospirosis. And Guy Joseph welcomes an investigation into alleged corrupt practices into the Yurinora International Airport redevelopment project. That's a broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Pooley. I'm wishing you a very good evening. Do not forget to join me 8:30 tonight for News Maker Live right here on DBS Television. See you in just a bit.